of America. Welcome to Unapologetic Live.
Madam.
Sit down. Oh. Welcome to Unapologetic Live. I'm your host, Amal Epinobi. Today we have plenty of stories to cover. Repeat line. Plenty of stories to cover. We're going to be... I can't seriously... Guys, we don't use a teleprompter on this show, you know it, but we do have a big man, I will say, in this country who's carrying quite a big position of power, who uses a teleprompter, but somehow can't do it properly. And if anything, even more so than being funny, it's sad. It is sad. We won't name him by name. I think you guys know who I'm talking about. We're going to move on here. Today, we have plenty of stories to cover, as it is Fun Friday, and we're going to be doing a week in review. Taylor's here.
Yo, 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 yo. Sorry, you caught me looking at the chat for a second.
All good. So we're going to be covering several things that have been popping up in the news today, some of which are trending on Twitter. Morton Steakhouse, which I never thought I'd be talking about on this show, is trending because Brett Kavanaugh tried to sit and have a meal there, and to no avail, because leftist activists had to come and confront him about his abortion views, which is great. Then we have Macy Gray, who is harikari'd essentially, and apologized to the woke mob for making statements about a woman being a woman. From there, we're going to get into the ACLU claiming that kids can transition at any point, you know? You're never too young. We'll talk about men being able to breastfeed. And lastly, Brittany Griner, who is now, imprisoned and has been imprisoned in Russia. But first, I need to fix my headphones that are on the ground here. Let's go. So, story number one. Morton Steakhouse. Like I said, never thought I'd be talking about this on today's show. Here's the headline out of The Hill. Morton's condemns abortion rights protesters for disrupting Kavanaugh's freedom to eat dinner. We like to think we all have the freedom to eat dinner, right? We can go out, we can go sit down with our families, we can go to the movies, we can go to the park, we can go to sports events, we can go anywhere we'd like to, and hopefully not be met with a group of angry protesters out for your blood and your condemnation. But that doesn't seem to be the case for Justice Kavanaugh. Morton Steakhouse, if you guys are unfamiliar, is a very popular steakhouse franchise, I think, across the United States. We have several here in California. And Brett Kavanaugh went there. We'll read the article here. Supreme Court Justice Brett Kavanaugh, one of the conservative justices who voted to overturn Roe v. Wade last month, was forced to exit through a back door of Morton Steakhouse in downtown Washington, D.C. by protesters who had learned he was there. Protesters gathered outside the steakhouse on Wednesday night upon learning that Kavanaugh was inside and called the restaurant's manager demanding that the justice be kicked out, according to Politico's Daniel Lipman. Imagine the sense of entitlement you must have to see somebody else eating at a restaurant, hear that they're there, you get up, you show up, and you call the manager and tell them that they should be kicked out. A paying patron, a respectful patron, might I add, who's just sitting trying to enjoy a meal, and you come and tell them that they should be kicked out. But that's not the end of it. Morton's condemned the actions of the protesters, luckily, writing to Politico, Honorable Supreme Court Justice Kavanaugh and all of our other patrons at the restaurant were unduly harassed by unruly protesters while eating dinner at our Morton's restaurant. Politics, regardless of your side of views, should not trample the freedom at play of the right to congregate and eat dinner, the statement continued. There is a time and place for everything. Disturbing the dinner of all of our customers was an act of selfishness and void of decency. Kavanaugh was ultimately forced to leave through the back door exit after protests built outside the main door of Morton. So you have all these people coming at you. Imagine how fearful you might be as an individual that you are sitting on what is a normal day trying to have dinner and groups of people come and are screaming at you for your political beliefs. And he's no stranger to this. We all know Brett Kavanaugh had somebody show up at his house where he and his family live, armed, ready to kill him, ready to assassinate him for his political beliefs. This man has been through the ringer, I must say. The sexual assault allegations, which we both know, looked very, very fraudulent. The attempted assassination, all of the other protests that have ensued in the wake of him being placed on the Supreme Court, and now getting kicked out of a steakhouse while trying to eat dinner. And I know I'm gonna hear people say, oh, it's just dinner. It's just dinner. Who cares? It's not that big of a deal. It's not just dinner, you know? It's you leading your normal life. It's you being protected in this country. Even though you have differing political perspectives, it is wild to me that anybody could look at this and say this is the right thing, this is a good thing that these people did, and they can brush it off. Luckily, Morton Steakhouse did not. They put out that statement, which I commend them for, because it'd be very easy to look at this situation and all the angry, screaming people who are coming at your restaurant, your business, and go, oh, I'm so sorry. We should have kicked him out. We should have done something sooner. We should have pandered to the unpaying entitled protesters who show up outside of our restaurant to have somebody, a patron, kicked out. How ridiculous do you have to be? But that's where we're at right now. And that's what I really think is the underlying truth here is we've emboldened them to be like this. We really have. The woke left has been taught that if we scream loud enough, if we are aggressive as we possibly can be, people are going to apologize. And we're going to get to a story of apology later on in the show today. But that's what they've learned. I get aggressive, I scream, I shout, I call out companies, I call the manager, I make myself seen. Not only do I make myself seen, but I block other people from being able to leave, to live their lives in ways like getting dinner. And if I do that enough, and if I'm super aggressive about it, guess what? They're gonna pander to me and they will cave. They will cave to what I do. And that's their tactic, day in and day out. Let's be aggressive as possible so that we can get people to bend to whatever illogical, irrational, non-based in reality whim that we have on any given day. So even Kavanaugh, like if I was Justice Kavanaugh, I know there's fear for one's safety and things like that. If they were able to keep the people outside of Morton's, I would have just sat there, cut the steak, ate it, and just looked them. I would honestly be like, excuse me, manager, can I sit right by the window out the front? Where all those people are, if they had security, of course, I'm not trying to get myself killed. But if they had security, you know, you have something to say? I'm going to continue eating my food. In fact, can I get dessert as well? Let's bring out another course. Let's bring out another drink. And I would sit there and I would have those people waste their time, waste their energy, waste their screaming, waste their stupid signs that they bring to these protests that they do. And I would just revel in the fact that these people are willing to waste so much energy to disrupt your dinner.
Dang.
I'm just saying.
Thug life, Amma. I see the sunglasses coming down right there, just ready to drop that on them.
That's how I feel about it.
I love that.
That's how I feel about it. That's how you should confront people like this. Because as loud as they're going to be, they're cowards. They truly are cowards, as emboldened as they feel. Cowards. And the worst thing that you can do when confronted with angry cowards like this is cower in your own way and let them know that they've caused you discomfort. Because now all these people, we're going to go through Twitter and actually look at what people are saying in regard to this. It's ridiculous. All these people are like, yay, yeah, force him out of his restaurant. Make him leave. Who cares that he doesn't get dessert? Let's read some of these. This is Jessica Kirsten. She says, just a thought. I'd rather be forced to leave Morton's for being harassed than forced to have a baby after being raped by my uncle. I just can't deal with the amount of stupidity that is expressed on the app that is Twitter. And now Elon Musk's deal of buying it has apparently fallen through, so we're going to have to deal with a lot more of it while not having our voice to respond to it. But again, I don't need to get into what the overturning of Roe versus Wade means. I'll simply say it goes back to your states, and most people, especially those who have been raped and are seeking an abortion, are going to be able to get their abortion, whether it be in their state or another. So that's off the table. But look how comfortable people are with ruining the livelihoods of others. That should be a very scary thing to hear. Because that means that no matter what happens to you, you know, the most atrocious, heinous crime can be committed against you, and they'll look at you and go, well, what's your political beliefs? It's honestly tantamount to what women used to complain about after sexual assault allegations when they go, well, what are you wearing? Is that not the same thing? When you watch somebody who is having a crime committed against him, not in this case, we can talk about harassment, we could talk about possibly stalking as a crime there, and then they go, oh, well, what are your political beliefs then? Did you deserve it because you are a conservative on the Supreme Court? Did you deserve it because you think that men are men and women are women? Did you deserve it because you voted for Donald Trump in the last election? That is exactly what it is. So to all the leftists who cry about, oh, what was she wearing? Well, you're doing the exact same thing. You're doing the exact same thing. Let's read another tweet here. I heard Kavanaugh had to endure a back alley abortion. No, sorry. He had to walk into a back alley in D.C. after eating a steak dinner at $200 per plate Morton's. Boo effing who? Next one. What did Brett Kavanaugh and his right-wing Supreme Court pals think their lives would be like after they criminally assaulted 200 million American women? Did they think people would just smile at them in restaurants? Also, goodbye, Morton's, for aggressively taking Kavanaugh's side. Aggressively. To go, hey, guys, regardless of political beliefs, can you not harass somebody in our restaurant that's aggressively taking Kavanaugh's side? Is it? No, of course it is not. Of course it is not. And criminally assaulting 200 million American women. Give me a break. Give me a break. Is this the twisted reality that some people live in? Yes. And I can't imagine what your day-to-day must look like if this is the reality that you live in. They would be so uncomfortable with this if this was anybody on their side having to endure these types of attacks, this type of stalking, this type of harassment. They would be crying and screaming and talking about how we need justice. They would build a thousand nonprofit organizations that are fighting for this one singular person, screaming, say their name. But when it happens to somebody that they disagree with, oh, it's totally fine. It's totally fine. Let's read one more here. Justice Brett Kavanaugh was forced to exit Morton's restaurant through a back door after protesters show up. Sadly, Kavanaugh could not have dessert. Because of Kavanaugh, a sexual predator, women no longer have rights over their own bodies. F Kavanaugh's wants and feelings. You heard it here first, folks. 6,000 likes on that. If you disagree with somebody politically, who cares about your wants? Who cares about your feelings? You are completely dehumanized. You are no longer a human, and you don't deserve the value that comes along with having a human life. You don't deserve dignity. You don't deserve compassion. And at the very least, you don't deserve to sit in a space that you are paying to sit at without being bothered by ignorant protesters. And this is where we're at. And it's no surprise, you know. I'll tell you a story from my time on the left. I don't know if I'll get into specifics because it might give away the organization that I was working for. But when I was in Florida working for a left-leaning organization as a youth organizer, there was an incident that made a lot of headline news in the state of Florida. And I believe even nationally this made news. A person from my organization, a man, found out that a certain conservative public servant was going to be going to the movies with her family. And she went to the movies with her family, her husband and her children, to see Mr. Rogers, the Mr. Rogers movie. And what did they do? He and his cohort showed up, followed her in, and harassed her while she was trying to go to the movies. And everybody at the organization that I was working for cheered this on. I mean, in lockstep. And this is the exact same thing that has happened in this situation. And it's because this culture is being bred with the ideology that if somebody disagrees with you, they don't deserve comfort. And in fact, if you can be the one, if you can be the person to bring them that discomfort, better for you. You can go home and pat yourself on the back after doing it. And it's disgusting. It truly is. I cannot imagine disliking somebody so much that I feel the need to not only use my own time to find out where they are, but once I do, go where they are, harass them, scream at them while they are just trying to live their lives. But are we surprised by this? When we have videos like this, Samantha Bee, a very popular leftist who has her own talk show, and this is what she's able to say live on air.
I can't describe how painful it is to be here now in a place where the Supreme Court has the power to erase 50 years of constitutional law. Make no mistake, this is not where it ends. Conservatives will not rest until they have come for all of our rights. Everything we have fought for could be lost unless we take it back. It's not just about voting in November. It's about doing everything in our power to protect and help vulnerable people access abortion across state lines. And we have to raise hell in our cities, in Washington, in every restaurant Justice Alito eats at for the rest of his life. Because if Republicans have made our lives hell, it's time to return the favor. I can't just...
For the rest of his life. And this very specific, in every restaurant. I wonder who they were inspired by, possibly. Could it have been that they watched this Samantha Bee and they just parroted everything that she's saying and follow it in lockstep in their own livelihoods, in their own lives? Go to every restaurant for the rest of his life. Can you imagine? You know, I feel pity for people who are like this. How tortured of a soul you must be to allow your whole life to be dictated and scribed out by what other people are doing with theirs, by who people that you don't even like are doing. If you didn't like somebody, I imagine you'd want to be as far away from them as possible. But instead, what these people want to do is find every place that they go to and be right there. Shame on the people who do this. Shame on them. And you know, they probably won't live to regret it because their minds aren't open enough to even form a thought about how distasteful it is to do something like that. But alas, here we are. I'm glad that Morton's, as hopefully a franchise, has stood up and said this is not acceptable whatsoever. And in a time where this is being really brushed off, and if not brushed off, encouraged, what do you think is the end goal here? What do you think this ends as? Because if it starts with harassing people at movie theaters, with going to the restaurants that they're eating at, with following them when they're with their families, does it maybe lead to the crazies that we see who go armed to places like Justice Kavanaugh's house, where his family and his children live? Isn't that the ideology itself, that practice coming to full fruition? Isn't that how it ends? Especially if we're encouraging it and telling people that they're doing a good thing by harassing other people? I have a feeling that people will be pretty inspired by that. And they'll go, okay, well, we got the restaurant. How can we do more? What's next? But we're the ones who incite violence, right? We're the ones who, when we say fight like hell, but do it peacefully, we're the ones inciting violence. We're in fact insurrectionists. We're in fact a threat to democracy. I can't think of a bigger threat to democracy than having your politicians, public officials, Supreme Court justices not be able to lead their normal lives because of fear that they will be attacked and harassed like this. That seems like a threat to democracy. But is CNN, MSNBC, ABC, are they going to run the story like that? No. No, they won't. They'll cheer it on.
And it's training people, too, to our leaders are saying we resolve our differences not through working within the system through legitimate means, not through winning the argument by forming better lines of reasoning than our opponents. It's no, we bully people into submission. Mm-hmm. We shame people. It's steps away from violence. And it's not surprising that we do get the crazy people who do push over the edge, like the guy who showed up at Brett Kavanaugh's family home and with a rifle and said, "I'm here to kill him."
Yep.
But that's a horrible thing. That is a threat to democracy, but even more so is the collapse of the mechanisms by which we resolve our differences. And if we descend into a place where we are bullying each other and it's a fight for power in that way, that is how democracy collapses.
Yeah.
And we looked earlier this week, I think yesterday's episode, at some political ads, and just we were lamenting at the state of politics in America, that it's become this theater and this caricaturization of one another. But another layer of that is we're losing our sense of like lowercase l liberalism, which is like using free speech to discuss differences and using representative government and your system of checks and balances and working within that to establish laws and govern yourself. And instead it's becoming mob rule, and it's looking more like this, if you don't get your way, then go out and shame people, go out and bully them, go out and bully politicians. It's not a healthy direction that we're headed in.
No, not at all. And to your point there, yeah, you can tell their goal is not discussion. And there will be some people who say, well, we just wanted to talk to him. We just showed up to the steakhouse in order to talk to him. How else are we going to air our grievances? You didn't show up to talk. You showed up to get somebody to submit to you. That's all that you want. And I can't imagine that anybody can look at that and think that that's effective. We show up and harass him and stalk him. That's going to get him to change his mind. He's going to go to work the next day and go, you know what? I really think we should rethink that Roe versus Wade overturning opinion that we all drafted, guys. I really think we need to work on that because 20 people just showed outside the restaurant that I was at and tried to harass me. Very, very effective. And in that same vein, you saw the news today of the former Japanese prime minister being assassinated, shot and killed. And you saw news publications, I forget the name of the specific news publication, go, you know, former Prime Minister Shinzo Abe, a hard conservative, and like really negative attachments to the fact that this man was a conservative. And then they talk about the fact that he's assassinated. You can tell in the subtext, they're saying, oh, well, he's a horrible conservative and he deserved it. That's why he got what he got. And that's why he was assassinated. If you allow that culture to be fostered, the tweet was later deleted, but if you allow that culture to be fostered, and clearly that's how people feel, what do you think that means for us? Not good.
It was NPR, by the way.
NPR. National Public Radio, which we just talked about earlier this week on the show. NPR. And what did they directly...
Sure, I'll read it.
Read it.
Former Japanese Prime Minister Shinzo Abe, a divisive arch-conservative and one of his nation's most powerful and influential figures, has died after being shot during a campaign speech. A divisive arch-conservative.
A divisive arch-conservative. You know what that means. They're saying he deserved it. It's essentially the subtext of that he deserved it, is what they're saying. And they got it got deleted, obviously, because there was a bit of outrage attached to people who read that. But that's what they really think. They put it out there, and even though it's deleted now, that's what they really think, guys. So it's no surprise that people are being confronted in restaurants and at the movie theater, and we have people like Samantha Bee saying that they should not know peace and that it's time to make their lives hell. And the worst thing that you can do, as I said before, is submit. The worst thing that you can do is apologize. Now we're going to move on to a story where somebody has done exactly that. Well, not exactly. In a roundabout way, done exactly that. Macy Gray, who you all know, is... I don't know that you all know her. She has been known to be quite the leftist. She did an interview to talk on Piers Morgan, and the subject matter of what it means to be a woman came up. And Macy Gray stated that even though we have men going out and getting surgeries and changing their parts and all these things and then saying they're a woman, it does not make them a woman. She said, I'm sorry, that's how I feel. It does not make you a woman, no matter what you do to yourself, no matter what you say, it does not make you a woman. After that was aired, of course, the woke mob came for Macy Gray's throat. And she didn't back down. She got all the hate messages. She got the death threats. She went through what is the normal course for saying something like that. And in fact, tweeted out, all of you coming on my page, threatening me and calling me names, just because I said something you don't agree with, be whatever you want to be, and F off, is what she said in a poorly spelled, full of grammatical error message on Twitter. But respect. I read that and I said, respect. 100% respect what you just did there. This is the only really right answer when it comes to people coming at you in this way. But alas, it did not last long as Macy Gray went on the Today Show and had this conversation about the controversial happenings.
We're back with Grammy-winning singer Macy Gray. She came onto the music scene more than two decades ago, and now Macy's getting ready to drop her latest album. It is called The Reset.
Look at how just like sad, scared, defeated she looks.
She is going to be performing one of the songs off that album in just a few minutes. Macy,
yeah.
It's good to see you. I actually feel like I've seen a lot of you in the past few days recently.
Yeah.
You were on the Piers Morgan show, and there was a question about trans women. And this was what you said in part. As a woman, just because you go change your parts doesn't make you a woman. If you want me to call you a her, I will, because that's what you want, but that doesn't make you a woman. Just because I call you a her, just because you've got a surgery, you can call yourself whatever you want. There was a wave of backlash that
right.
came as a result.
Right.
Just tell me where you are right now on that statement.
Well, I never, of course, never meant to hurt anybody with what I said. I'm actually a huge, I think it takes a lot of courage to be yourself, to go out in the world and be honest about who you are. And so I think anyone who is in the LGBT community is a hero and sets an example for all.
You can just tell, first of all, she's not said that I take back the statements that I made when I said them to Piers Morgan. She still believes exactly what she said, but is now uncomfortable in saying it because of the responses she's gotten and probably because her entire team has told her, Macy, you got to walk this back. You got an album coming out. We want people to buy it. We don't need the controversy. We don't need people calling you a transphobe. We need to get you out there and publicize you retracting this statement in some way, shape, or form. So you can tell. She still agrees with exactly what she said at Piers Morgan. LGBT people are heroes? For what? For what? You get an entire month out of the year. You're fully accepted. Legally, you're completely equal. There's really no more battle to be waged ahead other than the fact that a lot of people are pushing for kids to be able to transition at this point. So I don't know exactly where that statement came from other than we're just trying to placate, you know, to make people feel better about the entire situation. I'm so sorry. Do I accept people for whatever sexuality they have and whatever they want to be? Trans when they're adults. But no, you're not a hero. I'm sorry. I'm not a hero just because I was born a black female and I'm accepting of that. Taylor's not a hero because he is who Taylor is. You have to do things to get the label of being a hero. And coming out about your sexuality or whatever your gender is certainly not something worthy of being called a hero.
All of us with that, you know? So I said some things didn't go over well, but my intention was never to hurt anybody. I feel bad that I did hurt some people. And I think it's just about education. It's about conversation and us getting to a point where we understand each other. And that only happens with, you know, I've learned a lot through this. Mm-hmm. So I think that was one of the reasons it might have happened. Just it was a huge learning experience for me.
You know, it's just sad when they start saying they've learned something in the experience. What did you learn? You learned that there's probably hundreds of thousands of people who are batshit crazy. It's like, I don't know. What else did you learn? I don't know what else you could have possibly learned other than the fact that it's not okay to accept reality anymore in the United States of America.
And I just have a compassion for you know, what I think you can... Like I said in there, you can call yourself what, like you whoever you believe you are, mm-hmm. and no one can dictate that for you or take that away from you, you know?
Yeah. I think life is an education process. The more you sit with people, the more you talk to people, it changes your perspective. So has your perspective changed, do you feel?
I've learned so much, and I think, you know, being a woman is a vibe, and it's something I'm very proud of, and it's very precious to me, and I think that if you, in your heart, feel that that's what you are, then that's what you are, regardless of what anybody says.
Now, she's not exactly wrong with the statements she just made. Let's walk this back. First of all, the interview. Oh, and Macy, did we learn something today? Like she's a kindergartner? Like she's 4 years old? Did we learn that C comes after B and then D after C, Macy? Can you now write the alphabet out? Can you write that man can be woman and woman can be man, Macy? And she's like, oh, I certainly learned a lot. That's honestly the best. I don't know what else you can... I certainly learned a lot about the BS that other people think in this life. I've certainly learned a lot. But the condescending attitude that these people come at you with when they need the lesson. Macy should be turning back to her and being like, did you learn that women are typically born with these parts and men are typically born with these parts, even though some men want to, you know, adopt women characteristics, they can't be a woman. That's how that exchange should have gone. But we're in clown world where everything's upside down and right is wrong and wrong is right and black is white and all these things. And instead, we're watching the exact opposite take place right in front of our eyes. But I will talk about something that Macy, I think, is absolutely right about. If somebody truly believes that is what they are, then to themselves, that is what they are. You're going to have a very hard time convincing somebody of anything different if that is who they truly deep down believe themselves to be. But does that mean that they get to turn around and make you submit to what they think they are? No, no. And that's exactly how I treat all of this stuff. You know, yes, you're a grown adult and you want to go get the surgery and do all that. By all means, do that. You want to call yourself a woman? By all means, you do that. You want to change your pronouns? By all means, you do that. Do not then turn around and tell me I got to do it, because that's not how life works. You can do anything to serve your own self-image and what you believe. And by golly, if you believe that you're a woman, I imagine you're going to believe you're a woman for quite some time. But it is not my job to believe that with you. Let's see her closing statement here.
Well, thanks. You know what I'm saying?
Okay.
So, but yeah, I've learned a lot, absolutely. Right. And I'm glad I did, now I know.
Well, thank you for clearing that up, because I think people got confused, and people, sometimes you realize that through education, you feel differently about things.
No, baby. No, she doesn't. She doesn't. You know she got off, she took that hot mic off, and she's like, women are women. I'm so sorry. I'm a woman. She's a woman. The woman I just talked to. But... they're not. I don't know how else to cut the cake for you. And it's just sad to see somebody just like shrivel into themselves. She speaks about, you know, it takes true courage to be yourself. And it's courage that she was not able to find in this moment, which is really sad. Mm. To say that out loud on TV, yet be doing the exact opposite in this entire 3-minute segment. It is courageous to be yourself. You got to get through a lot of roadblocks, a lot of blinders, a lot of perceptions of what other people expect from you and what other people want to see from you and what other people's visions of success are for you to go, you know what? No, I'm gonna do my own thing. I'm gonna use my own perception. I'm gonna use my own expectations of myself, and I'm gonna truly be myself. And the fact that she couldn't do that here and stand strong in it is just real sad to me.
Yeah, you're right. It takes courage to say 2 + 2 = 4 when the whole world is saying 2 + 2 = 5.
Right.
And this whole time we're watching this, I was just like thinking, this feels like a piece of propaganda in a totalitarian state where somebody's, you know, violated the party standards and said something they shouldn't have said. And it's like, okay, well, this is your act of penance to get back into the good graces, and we'll have mercy on you. Yep. And not excommunicate you from the party if you come back in and you're a public figure, so you have to correct what you said. And, you know, isn't it nice that you learned, you know, that we can educate ourselves and come to a different perspective? And it's scary, because if you're, once you see it through that lens, you can't unsee just the way that our culture seems to work these days, which is there is sort of this progressive orthodoxy that you are expected to pay lip service to and subscribe to. And, you know, Macy Gray, you can see like the tension in her soul of like, well, I don't want to completely sell myself out, but I know I need to submit. And it's just like this defeated feeling that she has, which is also, by the way, how people feel in totalitarian societies.
Yes.
And that's kind of what it feels like. That's increasingly what we're living in, is this like soft totalitarianism where you no longer think for yourself and have courage to be an individual, as she says is what the heroic thing to do is. But the irony is, as you so brilliantly pointed out, is she's doing the opposite of that by affirming what she knows to be untrue. So it's just a mess.
It really is a mess. And yeah, you liken it to these totalitarian states. We've reacted to videos out of the concentration camps for Uyghur Muslims in the CCP under the Chinese Communist Party. And it's like, you can see it with your eyes that these people are just shriveled, had their livelihood stripped away from them, have everything that they believe stripped away from them. But the video goes, well, look, Salem here is able to do paintings while she's in the camps here, while she's getting re-educated. And Salem's, oh, I love painting, yes. It's so great to be here, and look at all the things that I've created. Oh, well, Marcos over here, he does model architecture. Look at all the art that he's, yes, it's so great to be here. And I completely agree, and I'm so happy that they've done this to me, because I've learned so much. I've learned so much in the re-education camp since I've been here. It's through line. And you have a spectrum of, okay, it's not as severe to be Macy Gray, who's a popular musical artist, who's on the Today Show talking about it, and it's fairly severe to be in a literal concentration camp under the Chinese Communist Party, but the tune is the same. The tune is the same. We just have to progress from one state to the other. So you have to decide as an individual, yeah, no, I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to do that, because giving away that small piece of yourself is tantamount to doing the same on a much larger scale. And that's where it's headed if you don't say something, if you don't stand up. Macy should have went on the Today Show and been like, no, I didn't change my mind at all. Nothing changed my mind. And, you know, I'm so glad. She should have, in fact, been like, yeah, I'm going to come on and apologize. Yeah, put me on the show. And go, no, absolutely not. And I wanted to be on the Today Show to say it so that millions of people could hear me say that I'm not taking those statements back. Also, buy my new album. And you know what people would have done? Conservatives who don't even agree with Macy Gray would have went and bought her album and said, because you were courageous and you stood up and you stood by your beliefs, I'm going to support you even though I don't agree with you most of the time. That's what would have happened. But instead we cower. Instead we shrivel into ourselves, and we roundabout apologize to the people who don't care if you live or die. They do not care. Macy Gray could have gone on the Today Show that day, said those things, walked out and got hit by a bus. And the people who she just apologized to would not care at all. They would not care at all. So it's a waste. And in the meantime, as Macy Gray is walking back on her definition of what it means to be a biological woman or a biological man, fatherly, Yeah, the Fatherly is the name of this publication, this magazine. Why can't men breastfeed? Fatherly, if you remember them, we've covered them on the show today. I mean, before, is the exact same publication who, when Pride Month came around, put out an article saying, yes, you should bring your child to the Pride parades, even though there are going to be sexual kinks and naked people and all of these performative sexual acts. It's totally fine to bring your child. In fact, you should encourage it to your children. Fatherly headquarters is what said that. And now they're telling you, well, why can't men breastfeed? Why can't we take the, you know, the role of a lactating mother and instead call it a man? Why can't that be a husband? Why can't that be something that we acknowledge as having the pronouns he, her, I mean, he, him? Why is that not possible? And if we allow them to descend into madness, they will descend into madness.
And this isn't, by the way, this is something that got wind of because Twitter put it in their featured events of the day. So this is like anybody who's logged into Twitter just sees this Fatherly article promoted. And so there's the double whammy of this insanity that's bent on calling into question gender roles and sexuality and all this stuff. Mm-hmm. And then there's Twitter platforming it, which now is not going to be owned by Elon Musk, as far as we can tell. So looks like we got more of this to look forward to.
So our jobs aren't going anywhere anytime soon. The culture war continues. We're going to be here. Our last story of the day is covering Brittany Griner. You know her, or probably don't know her, because who watches the WNBA? But you know her now. You probably just heard of her because she got arrested in Russia on drug charges while she was there. Drug smuggling charges. I believe she had marijuana and went to the airport and was arrested in Russia for breaking Russian law. Now, she's been asking our president, our repeat the line president, to bring her back home. Although Griner has a history of criticizing the U.S., saying the national anthem should not be played, and has spent months protesting the United States of America. The U.S. sure comes in handy when you need freedom, doesn't it? Doesn't it? But while we're here, we can criticize it, and criticism is fine, okay? But sheer outright hatred towards your country is maybe something that she's going to reconsider once her time is served. Because I believe she is going to just be serving time. They're going to treat her as if she is a Russian person who broke Russian law, even though you're an American. Turns out your American protections don't exactly follow you when you go to other countries, and it is smart to keep up on the laws of the country that you are in, for you could face issues like being arrested for drug smuggling in Russia. Honestly, I feel bad for her. I feel bad, especially if it was just marijuana. I'm like, oh, I feel real bad for you. But also, know the rules of the country that you're in. This has happened before to, I believe, several Americans at this point. I think there was one in, was it like Singapore or Vietnam, a young man who...
North Korea?
That's a different one. The North Korean guy, he stole a poster of some sort now is dead because of the way he was treated in North Korean prison. I think there was another kid who went to Singapore, broke a law there, and was convicted of charges and then just beaten with a stick. I believe he was given like 6 whippings, and then the U.S. had to negotiate with the country to get it down to 4, which still is quite the beating. I can't imagine having to withstand that, but it's a double thing. You know, you gotta first know what you're getting into when you go to another country, and maybe be hypervigilant about not breaking the laws there, and two, maybe have a little bit more appreciation for your country. And I mean, as far as this goes, sure, let the U.S. help her and see if they can help her out of this situation. I'm sure it was just an ignorant moment where she didn't realize that other countries were not going to be as forgiving for her actions as the United States was. And if you can help somebody who is a prominent figure in the U.S. get out of a sticky situation in another country, I'm not going to be angry if they go and try to help her in this situation. She's got a young, budding career in the WNBA. Maybe. I don't know. try maybe to help her out and see if you can do anything about what is going on with her. But again, stupid, stupid games.
Will she stand for the anthem at the next do they even play the anthem in WNBA games?
That's a
question. But will she?
Is she going to sing a different song if the U.S. helps her out of this whole sticky situation she's in Russia and she comes back? Or is it still going to be the Black Lives Matter, kneel for the anthem, I don't want the anthem, I hate the U.S. type thing? Because the U.S. starts to look real good when you go to any other country. And I can't stress that enough. The criticism that we levy to our own government will probably look a lot smaller when you go to other countries and see what is going on over there and see the freedoms that can be stripped from you at any given moment. This last tweet from NPR, of course NPR, the highest WNBA salary is about $228,000 a year. On the NBA, Over $45 million. That stark pay inequity has pushed many WNBA players to play overseas where they can earn more. I don't know what you want me to say, NPR. Once more than two people start watching the WNBA, we can talk about... I'm actually surprised they make $228,000 a year. I was shocked to see that. I don't know what I thought it was going to be, but definitely not $228,000 per year. That's good. That's solid. That's a one percenter.
Yeah.
You're a one percenter in America. You're making that. And you play for the WNBA. Once, I don't know, tell Brittany Griner to dunk. Once she dunks, then we could talk about maybe 230.
She might be able to, in all fairness. I don't know. There's a couple NBA, WNBA.
I know. There's like two or three, right? There's like two or three. Where like dunking is the standard for the NBA.
That's the extent of my WNBA knowledge
Fair enough. It's impressive, I will say, for a woman to be able to dunk, considering the distinct biological disadvantage for men. It is very impressive. Okay, so I don't want to discount that what they're doing is, you know, an athletic feat. I'm just saying.
But I think it's interesting, though, that NPR's reaction to the spin that they put on this news is it's the gender pay gap's fault that Brittany has to play overseas. And so it's not her fault for
breaking the law
in another country. It's gender pay gap's fault. Right. It's like news stories only spin in one direction for all of these outlets every time. And it doesn't matter what happens. It's always something that can make America look bad, look like it has systemic issues, look like there's systemic racism or sexism or whatever. And so whatever happens in the world, let's spin it back toward ways to denigrate the United States.
Absolutely. And that's exactly what they've done here. No mention of the fact that she was breaking the law.
Mm.
Come on. Can't say she's forced to be in the position that she's in. She's a WNBA player. Okay. She's not forced to be anywhere she doesn't want to be. They make choices to do that. And if you want to go to another country to play to earn more, that's your choice. Nobody's holding a gun to your head and making you do it. So I don't know what this argument is here. You get paid for what you, the revenue you bring in. Soon as the WNBA brings in revenue, they'll probably get paid more. But at the moment, $228,000 is pretty sufficient, I think.
Yeah, that's substantially more than the average globally woman makes, and you know, in the United States, and especially black women, etc. So
I guess it's not 1%. I don't know what the 1% technically the 1% margin is, but it's up there. Come on, 220. How many of you guys are making 228? And if you are, good for you. The heck? Mm-hmm. Great for you guys. Apparently, Kofi Kwe says, yeah, she can dunk, I think. And then 876 Van Red said, barely get over the hoop. So I don't know which one. If she can dunk, very impressive. If she can't, WNBA.
So. Here's my question. So when she gets out of this and comes back to the United States, will she be more grateful having seen how unjust or strict Russia and other countries can be, or will she be angry at the United States for not resolving this issue more quickly?
Oh, I don't know because I don't. Yeah, we should honestly make that a poll. I don't know because I don't know. Oh, man. I'm tempted to be optimistic and say, oh, well, everything she's gonna realize that the U.S. has something to offer and is better. But the old leftist in me makes me say that she's going to blame it on somebody else. She'll read the headline of this NPR article, and then she'll become a Megan Rapinoe talking about how the female players need to get paid more. I'm going to go with the latter. She's going to blame the U.S. She's going to blame the U.S.
All right, I'm putting a poll on the Unapologetic channel on YouTube, so if you guys want to answer it, that's where to go.
That's where to go. Yeah, if you guys are watching on PragerU right now, go subscribe to my channel, Amal Epinobi, Unapologetic. And if you want to interact with this poll, give me your answers, go give it there. Yeah, I think she's going to come back and complain. What do you think?
Knowing it's like the same way that the news works in One Direction, I think these people's brains work in One Direction. And so I would have to say that she will be bitter at the United States for not solving this earlier. And for having to create the systemic sexism that made her go overseas to pursue more income in the first place.
Right. Oh, gosh. It's never ending, ladies and gentlemen. Now that Twitter is not being bought by Elon Musk, it's fallen through. I wonder why it's fallen through. Actually, let's check it out real quick and see if there's any explanation. I wonder if it's because of all the bot accounts and things like that. Let's see. Breaking news from Reuters. Breaking news. You guys know that fish from SpongeBob? Okay, let's see. Oh, it doesn't even explain.
It looked like one of those video
one of those
explainers.
Now this videos.
Yeah.
I promise
we're
I'm
very
not
prepared
stupid.
For the show, guys.
Yeah, we are. Okay, Elon Musk, the chief executive officer of Tesla and the world's richest person, said on Friday he was terminating his $44 billion deal to buy Twitter because the social media company has breached multiple provisions of the merger agreement. Twitter chairman Brett Taylor said on the microblogging platform that the board planned to pursue legal action to enforce the merger agreement. Twitter board is committed to closing the transaction on the price and terms agreed upon with Mr. Musk and plans to pursue legal action to enforce the merger agreement. We are confident we will prevail in the Delaware Court of Chancery. So wait. So Elon Musk is like, okay, I'm going to buy Twitter. Here's $44 billion. Let's write up the deal and everything. And then they write up the deal. And he's like, well, you're not holding to the provisions of the deal. I'm not going to buy Twitter anymore. And now they're suing so that he buys Twitter. Now they're going to try to force him to buy Twitter.
Oh, is that the case? Like. Well, the market did kind of crash like shortly after that offer that he made. So I'm sure their stock value went down precipitously.
I'm reading that right? The Twitter board is committed to closing the transaction on the price and terms agreed upon with Mr. Musk and plans to pursue legal action to enforce the merger. So now when they were like, oh, we don't want Elon buying Twitter, they're going to pursue legal action and try to make him buy it. Interesting.
Looks like it.
In a filing, Musk's lawyer said Twitter has failed to refuse to respond to multiple requests for information on fake or spam accounts. So it was the spam accounts that was a major problem on the platform, which is fundamental to the company's business performance. Twitter is a material breach of multiple provisions of that agreement, appears to have made false and misleading representations upon which Mr. Musk relied when entering into the merger agreement.
That makes
sense. Interesting. Musk also said that he was walking away because Twitter fired high-ranking executives and one-third of the talent acquisition team, breaching Twitter's obligation to preserve substantially intact the material components of its current business organization. Wow. So basically, he goes to buy Twitter. They're like, yeah, we have this many accounts. They didn't disclose how many of them are spam or bot accounts. And now they gutted the major parts that help the Twitter team work and then said, here's the company for you. Buy it up from us, which would be a smart thing to back out of that deal. But if it now goes to court, he might be forced. That will be very interesting to see. But yeah, this was a hope for us, you know? When we saw that Elon was deciding to buy Twitter to the tune of $44 billion, we cheered because Twitter, I'm sure you all know, has so much sway and influence over what people think, believe, see, read, all these things. And if you give it to somebody who actually values free speech and allows it to be a truly open open platform for everybody to express their ideas, we have not even an advantage. We just have an even playing field where we're able to combat some of the stuff that we're seeing right now. And without that, we are functioning at a severe disadvantage because they can quite literally frame out elections, frame out the headlines that you're reading, and frame your total perception of what it means to live in this country and what's going on. It's ridiculous.
Yeah. For better or worse, it is kind of the de facto town square of a modern society. It's a digital message board, basically, where people discuss and, I don't go to news sites anymore. I have my Twitter feed. That's how we find stuff for the show because it's the fastest place to get breaking news, and then you can follow specific people that whose opinions you trust and value, and get those, and then you can see other things that are rising in trend. So it's an inherently useful thing for a modern society. But the problem is it's in the hands of leftist activists who promote stuff like why can't men breastfeed
right.
every day. So that is not good. And then censor voices that they don't like Jordan Peterson was just banned for dead naming one actor, actress, Elliot Ellen Page.
Actor, actress.
We did cheer, and that was honestly one of the most hope-inspiring developments of the last year or so, was Elon Musk acquiring Twitter, or the prospect of that, because that does preserve, if we can preserve free speech, if we can preserve the mechanism by which we can determine the truth and determine the right ideas that we should be following as a society, then we have a chance. But if speech is controlled, that is very dangerous. And I don't want Elon Musk to get screwed over in this deal. I hope he somehow ends up with Twitter and doesn't have to pay an exorbitant amount. Then they've resolved these differences. But or at the very least, I was about to say, I hope Twitter has learned their lesson, but there's no way they do. Activists never learn.
No. So
sad
the battle
day.
Continues, and it has followed us to steakhouses, to Twitter, to athletes that are imprisoned in Russia. There are plenty of things to talk about, and with Elon Musk not taking over Twitter, we will have plenty more to talk about and go forth with. I hope you guys are settled in. Hope you got your seatbelts buckled, because the ride has just begun. And on that note, ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for watching. Please like, subscribe, click the notification bell to be notified every single day when we go live. That is 3 p.m. Pacific, 6 p.m. Eastern. If you want to listen to our podcast, go to Spotify, Google Play, Apple Podcasts, leave us a 5-star review, because the leftists leave 1-star reviews and we don't like that. Leave a comment down below today. What do I want to have you comment on? Do you think Brittany Griner is going to return from Russia with a newfound respect for the United States? Is she going to blame the United States, or will she just be quiet and go back to doing what it was that she was doing? Let me know your opinions down below. If there's something you wish I said but I didn't say, put that in the comments down below. If you disagree with me anywhere, or if you agree with me, let me know down below. And I think that's it, guys. I hope you have a fantastic weekend, and I will see you guys on Monday. Peace.